President Trump yesterday went back to blaming others for violence at the gathering of racist groups in Virginia, a weekend that began with hundreds of people carrying torches marching through Charlottesville while chanting Nazi and anti-Semitic slogans. On Saturday, as you know, a woman was killed and nearly two dozen injured when a car, allegedly driven by one of those white nationalist marchers, plowed into counter-protesters. The president initially blamed, quote, many sides for the violence, then relented to call out the KKK, neo-Nazis, and other hate groups eventually on Monday. The president reverted to his original statement yesterday that multiple sides were to blame for the violence. He explained his delay in condemning those groups specifically, while adding those marching alongside them included, quote, many fine people.
Do you think that what you call the alt-left is the same as neo-Nazis?
Those people, all of those people, excuse me.
That's my question.
I've condemned neo-Nazis. I've condemned many different groups, but not all of those people were neo-Nazis, believe me. Not all of those people were white supremacists by any stretch. Those people were also there because they wanted to protest the taking down of a statue, Robert E. Lee. So, excuse me, and you take a look at some of the groups and you see, and you know it if you were honest reporters, which in many cases you're not, but many of those people were there to protest the taking down of the statue of Robert E. Lee. So, this week it's Robert E. Lee. I noticed that Stonewall Jackson's coming down. I wonder, is it George Washington next week, and is it Thomas Jefferson the week after? You know, you really do have to ask yourself, where does it stop? But they were there to protest, excuse me. You take a look the night before. They were there to protest the taking down of the statue of Robert E. Lee.
From both sides, sir, you said there was hatred, there was violence on both sides.
I think there's blame on both sides. You look at both sides. I think there's blame on both sides, and I have no doubt about it, and you don't have any doubt about it either. And if you reported it accurately, you would say.
They showed up in Charlottesville.
Excuse me.
To protest.
Excuse me. They didn't put themselves down as you. And you had some very bad people in that group. But you also had people that were very fine people on both sides.
All right, along with Mike Barnicle, Casey Hunt, Michael Steele, Harold Ford, and Joe, joining us now from Philadelphia, MSNBC contributor and director of Africana Studies and professor of English at Lehigh University, Dr. James Peterson. Dr. Peterson, thank you for being with us this morning. Just want to get your initial reaction to what we saw yesterday, where the president was much more exercised about defending the protesters than he was about the woman who was killed in that crowd.
It's atrocious, Willie. And, you know, I'm listening to you and I'm listening to Mike Barnicle and everybody on the panel there this morning. I'm hearing the disgust. I'm hearing some of the anger, but I don't hear a lot of surprise. I think many of us are not surprised by this particular moment. This is more of a culmination of the Donald Trump that we've seen unfolding over the years from the birther Obama debacle into his campaign. The way in which he launched his campaign was steeped in the kind of rhetoric that speaks to the community of white supremacy and white nationalists. When you look at some of his policies, Willie, the policies, the Muslim ban, the Department of Justice that he's presiding over, there are things that smack of the kind of racism that we see seething beneath the surface of the neo-Nazi movement and of white supremacists and white nationalists. So I don't hear much surprise. It's sickening, but I don't hear much surprise because I think for many of us who've been paying attention to this, this is more of a culmination of the Donald Trump that we've seen engage in these kind of racialized antics over the last several years. It's not something that seems to me to be inconsistent with where he's been policy-wise or where he's been as a political campaigner. It's in some ways kind of the end of dog whistle politics, right? I mean, we used to talk about things like the Southern Strategy, which is supposed to be a subtle leveraging of race in political discourses, or we used to talk about the ways in which people would engage in dog whistle politics. But this is the end of that, right? Because now we have the president of the United States endorsing fringe groups that are engaged in racist ideology and doing so forcefully. You know, doing so, you know, he's the way that he's engaging media there, he's rejecting the legitimacy of the media for even raising the question of him trying to prevaricate about two different sides in this issue.
And that's Harold Ford, that's exactly what he's been doing for quite some time. Of course, attacking the media. calling them fake news, all while he's lying and spreading false information. I think you, as much as anybody, understands racial politics and sort of the dog whistle element of racial politics that were used against you in I think it was the 2006 campaign, which a lot of people were shocked by. And yet we've gone from that to where we are today. And as the professor said, we're well beyond dog whistle politics. This is just the president of the United States out and out saying that there's a moral equivalency between racists and people who are protesting against racists and racism in America.
You and four of the five here, and Casey will have the distinction, hopefully soon, of being not this but the other. We're fathers. What kind of father listens to people talk about his daughter and grandkids and treats them as being inferior to other people, takes the side of those making that case versus those who are protesting that characterization and that beneath the word and that beneath the line characterization? It's beyond me. I agree with everything the doctor said, everything that's been said this morning and what you've said. And it's hard to believe how Gary, how Steve, how Secretary Chow and others stand behind this guy. And others who support him. And again, I think a lot of the country was tricked. I've been criticized for saying I don't think a lot of people realized that they were getting this kind of president. So I can only hope that we can either just behavior changes on his part or people begin to walk away from him.
You know, Willie Geist, it bears repeating, as we said right after the election, that Donald Trump got elected president of the United States, won the Electoral College, even though he lost the popular vote, because people in Wisconsin and Michigan and Ohio and Pennsylvania, because part of them who voted for Barack Obama 8 years ago and made history, and we became the first majority white country to put a black man in the presidency. Those same people voted for Donald Trump. They didn't vote for Donald Trump because they were racist. They didn't vote for Donald Trump because they wanted this. They voted for Donald Trump because they were desperate for change. They wake up this morning, and they've seen this coming a long time, but maybe they thought that he was just saying it. Maybe they thought he wasn't going to follow through on it, even though he gave them plenty of reasons to by denying he knew who David Duke was in February of 2016 or talking about the Muslim ban in 2015. But they're waking up this morning. There can be no mistake. Donald Trump is who Donald Trump said he was throughout the campaign.
I talked to a couple of friends yesterday after this who were Trump voters in Pennsylvania. They voted for him. They voted for Barack Obama twice, but they voted for Donald Trump this time. They basically took a flyer on him. I mean, they didn't like Hillary Clinton particularly. They wanted Washington to change. They believe it had been rigid in the same place for generations, and they thought he was going to shake it up somehow. And I think you're right. I think they thought his words were just words, that he was saying what he had to say to get elected. But we've learned now over the last 7 months, and particularly in the last 4 days, that they were more than words, that they were his belief. And that if he's speaking to this small group, Michael Steele, that he believes makes up the core of his support, or maybe the sub-core of his support, and he is afraid of them, he's afraid of alienating those people who helped put him into office, so much so that, as Harold said, he's willing to go out and support a group of people who went on TV over the weekend and railed against his son-in-law for marrying the president's daughter and having her convert to Judaism. He's defending them against the people who are protesting that kind of thought.
He is, and I don't think it's because he's afraid of them. I think that's not what this is. I think Donald Trump is emboldened by them. He feeds off of them, and he feeds them. This is a symbiotic relationship that's formed as a result of the campaign itself. I mean, going back to something Joe just said, you know, to paraphrase Maya Angelou, if Donald Trump is telling us who he is, why won't we just stop and believe him? I think at this point we have to say, okay, now we know what we're dealing with here. And the country has got to make a decision. How do we move forward with this type of president who is so far outside the core values of this country? I don't care what stripe you walk in life. That's the dividing line right now. And so it's like a kid on the playground. It's like the bully on the playground. All right? Who is he afraid of? Right? Who's he afraid of? And more importantly, who does he respond to? Does he respond to the teachers? Is he concerned about the teachers coming in, the media in this case, in the case of Trump, the political parties coming after him and pushing back on him? No. What he's concerned about is the other kids on the playground, those he gets to bully and those who egg him on.
There's an added element to it, too, I would suggest, and I'm not smart enough to fully explain it, but it goes like this. That Donald Trump basically doesn't understand what he calls his base, his core constituency. He doesn't understand that it's made up of people who suffered a sense of loss along the way, whether they lost a son or a daughter in a 16-year-long war, whether they lost a house or an income in 2008 and 2009. They suffered a loss. So they voted for Donald Right. Trump. They're good people.
Right.
But now we are in, I would suggest, a watershed moment. And the watershed moment is for the country. Do we do something about what is happening to our country because the President of the United States doesn't know the country, doesn't really understand this great, good, broad, expansive country? Does he not understand the country? I would suggest he does not. So do we do something about it? A watershed moment here. And in terms of the...
What do you do, though, Mike? What does that mean?
I don't know. I'm not smart enough to figure that out. But given the accelerated pace of our culture and tweeting and Instagramming and everything like that, is this moment lost? Do we move on to something else? Or do we focus on what happened yesterday and what is happening to the presidency?
Well, let's talk for a second about that simple speaking out part, which we've obviously seen many Republicans do, many people who have sided with the president.
But they don't use his name.
And I want to bring up, too, Joe mentioned Elaine Chao. And she, of course, is the wife of Mitch McConnell. She was standing there next to the president. And she is somebody who has been the target of very direct racism over the course of her long time in public life, both as a political spouse and in her own right. And every time she has been directly attacked, she's been referred to as a Chinese wife. One person ran, you know, a campaign saying that they needed an all-American family in Kentucky. That's coded language if I ever heard it. And every time that's happened, Mitch McConnell has jumped straight to her defense. He has said, these are racial slurs. This is, you know, not acceptable. He hasn't done that yet. And Elaine Chao, still a member of President Trump's cabinet. Now, what actions could those people take to move this forward? Again, we may not be smart enough to say at this point, but I think, there's going to be some imperatives there.
I'll tell you what, at least going back to the only thing I have for my life experience, I can tell you there was a time back when something had happened, Willie, in Congress. And a group of us just said, we were going to stop. We were going to stop passing any legislation. We were going to stop voting to pass any rules. We were going to basically stop everything that happened in Congress until leadership sat down and talked to us. And we did. They called our bluff, and we voted no. And everything ground to a halt. Now, that was over some matter that was so much smaller than what we're dealing with now. But there is nothing that is stopping Mitch McConnell and Paul Ryan from coming out today, holding a joint press conference saying, we were offended by what the President of the United States said yesterday. And until the President of the United States comes to us, has a conversation with us, and convinces us that he regrets what he said yesterday and understands the errors of his way and is going to work for a more inclusive America, we're not going to pass any of his legislation and nothing will get done. They need to do that. They can do that. They have the power to do that. Read the Constitution. The House of Representatives itself holds the checkbook. Nothing gets done without the House and the Senate okaying it, Willie. And at this point, if this doesn't force them to do it, to come out and show courage, then absolutely nothing will. Because Mike's right. Donald Trump not only doesn't understand America, he doesn't understand the people that elected him President of the United States. He's focusing on a small, angry group of racists, bigots, neo-Nazis, white supremacists. Actually, the people that voted for him are a lot of working-class Americans that have seen their paychecks dwindle year after year after year over the last 30 years. And Donald Trump promised that he could make Washington work. Donald Trump promised that health care would be easy. Donald Trump promised them, I'm going to give you better health care coverage at less cost. Donald Trump promised, I'm going to cut your taxes. I'm going to make this country work again. Donald Trump promised, I'm going to make your wages higher. I'm going to make your life better. That's the promise he made them. Not that he would embrace David Duke, the Ku Klux Klan, white supremacists. He doesn't understand who elected him, and that, Willie, is why he's sitting at 32-34%, and why he has shamed himself and has shamed the office of the presidency and everybody who works for him.
The problem, Dr. Peterson, with Mitch McConnell and Paul Ryan approaching the President of the United States and asking him to say in no uncertain terms that he regrets what he said, is that he doesn't regret what he said. He had a chance to clean it up. He said it on Saturday. He spoke from his heart on Saturday when he ad-libbed the line about many sides. He tried to clean it up on Monday when he was pushed into a corner. And yesterday, he revealed to the country and the world what his true feeling on this matter was. So a conversation asking him to go out publicly and clean it up holds no water anymore. It's meaningless.
It doesn't. The back and forth has diminished the capacity for any kind of cleanup in terms of a political statement. And I agree with Joe here that it seems like it would only be a bit of courage on the part of some leaders in Congress to sort of step forward and try to salvage what's left of the Republican Party in the Trump era. But I think we would be remiss if we don't acknowledge the fact that this kind of presidency degrades the American political project. It downgrades what we can expect from politics. It downgrades the American people's capacity to trust in political thinking and political discussions. And so in that kind of context, it's difficult to see how a statement from Ryan announcing the president's name or how any statement from Mitch McConnell is going to somehow recover what's been diminished in this particular moment. But I want to say something else about what's dangerous about the president's statements, which is if you study white supremacist groups and you look at how they operate, you know, this idea that there's some boogeyman on the left, that there's people out to get them, the fact that he's validating that, that is really, really dangerous because in that world, the kind of sort of hyper announcement around the enemy ultimately does lead to violent outcomes. And so my sense is that this is very, very difficult to recover from given where we are in this particular political moment.
And as we said earlier, the president yesterday was more exercised and more animated when he was talking about how bad the counter-protesters were than he was talking about the people who killed Heather Heyer. Dr. James Peterson, appreciate having your eloquent voice in this conversation this morning. Thank you. Still ahead on Morning Joe, MSNBC's Joy Reid and the Washington Post's Bob Costa. And as we go to break, what did the president do after defending those at the white nationalist rally? He plugged the Trump winery in Virginia.
Does anyone know I own a house in Charlottesville?
Where is it?
Oh, boy. It's going to be. It's in Charlottesville. You'll see.
Is it near the winery or something?
It is the winery.
Will you go visit
I mean, I know a lot about Charlottesville. Charlottesville is a great place that's been very badly hurt over the last couple of days. I own actually one of the largest wineries in the United States. It's in Charlottesville.
Thanks for checking out MSNBC on YouTube, and make sure you subscribe to stay up to date on the day's biggest stories. And you can click on any of the videos around us to watch more from Morning Joe and MSNBC. Thanks so much for watching.